All right, everyone, welcome back to this week's experimental math semester. Today, we're very excited to have Carsten Schneider from RISC Linz speaking to us about difference ring algorithms for symbolic summations. So please go ahead, Carsten.
Okay, thanks for the great chance to present my research topic in your famous seminar. I'm very happy that Doron and you, Robert, invited me to give a talk in your seminar. And let's just start. The outline is as follows. I will start with a warm-up example to demonstrate the different machineries. Then I will go into details and will make it more clear in the difference ring setting. And in the third part, I want to show you some challenging applications. So let's look at the warm-up example, which actually arose within the evaluation of two-loop massive Feynman diagrams. You see here, it's a double infinite sum. So we sum over k and j from 0 to infinity. And the sum is built by two terms. The first one is a product of factorial, so it's a purely hypergeometric term in j, k, and n. And the second term is again a product of factorials times a linear combination that you see here of harmonic numbers. And in the following, I don't denote the harmonic numbers by h sub n, but by s sub 1 of n. So whenever you see an s 1, these are the nth harmonic numbers, okay? So if I see such a sum, then I start always thinking, let's try telescoping. So let's denote the summand by f. And you see that in the moment, I just say that it depends on j. I suppress the dependency on k and on the discrete parameter n. So given such a summand f depending on j, we look for an expression g of j such that this difference equation or this telescoping equation holds. In this particular instance, we find an expression again in terms of a product of factorials times another linear combination of harmonic numbers. By the way, you can plug in the expression g into this telescoping equation and you can verify correctness for all j from 0 on. So that's good because now we can sum this equation over j from 0 to a truncated version. What we gain is, so if we sum the left-hand side from j from 0 to a, we get that truncated sum version. And on the right-hand side, if we sum over j from 0 to a, all terms vanish by the telescoping trick, except at the upper bound plus 1 minus the lower bound. So what you see here is nothing else than the discrete version of indefinite integration. And since the telescoping equation holds for all j from 0 on, this identity holds. So we can plug in our concrete g and we get that expression. Now we send a to infinity because we want to scope the infinite summation quantifier. And now we look at the right-hand side and knowing that the harmonic numbers behave like the log function for large a, one can easily see that the factorials dominate the harmonic numbers and actually this expression which depends on a and that expression, which depends on A, both vanish. So what remains is purely the A free term. So basically we have derived that this applying the infinite summation quantifier on that summand yields an expression in terms of the harmonic numbers divided by this denominator. So let me demonstrate how this can be done with sigma. We load in the summation package sigma within Mathematica. We define this sum, and here we have only the truncated version. And then we apply the command sigma reduce to that sum. And we can basically, by the telescoping trick, eliminate the summation quantifier and get that expression. And finally, we use another command which is available in sigma, namely sigma limit, which performs the limit automatically, and we get that expression. So summarizing, using computer algebra tools, we can simplify that sum in terms to that expression, which is rather simple. Next, we apply the next summation quantifier. And please note, here is a k in the denominator, so we can start only from k equals 1 on. So the special case k equals 0 has to be treated separately. So let's repeat the game. Let's denote the summand by f again, and now it depends on k, the next summation variable. And I tried again to find a g, such that this telescoping equation holds. Unfortunately, there is no solution, no simple solution. So we can use the fact, so there are several options how one can proceed in sigma. One option is that we now rediscover that actually the sum also depends, or the summand also depends on the parameter n. Namely, we can use Doron Thalberger's ingenious idea that we not only use the summand, but we also use the shifted summand in n. And then we ask, is there a linear combination of the summand and the summand shifted in n with a linear combination where the parameters C0 and C1 are free of the summation variable, such that we find the telescoping equation? And in this case, indeed, it's possible we find C0, which is minus n, it's clearly free of k, and C1, it's n plus 2, which is again free of k, and we find an expression g, which depends on n and k, again in terms of the harmonic numbers. Again, we can verify the summand recurrence by plugging in all the ingredients and verify that within the summation range that we are interested in, the summand recurrence is valid. So now we repeat as telescoping. We sum this equation over k from 1 to a, and on the left-hand side, all terms vanish except at the upper bound plus 1 minus the lower bound. And on the right-hand side, we sum over this rather, in the first round, ugly looking summand. So we look at, we obtain that sum. But by linearity, we can split the two sums into two parts. And this is a crucial point. And we've managed to find constants C0 and C1, which are free of the summation variable. So we can pull it out. And please note now that that sum that you see here is precisely our AN. And that sum here that you see here is again that sum, but n is replaced by n plus 1. So in other words, we have found a recurrence of that expression, of that sum. So let's plug in the concrete components that we found, and we obtain basically that linear recurrence. Now again, we have to send a to infinity to deal with the infinite summation quantifier, and performing the limit on the left-hand side, we obtain that recurrence. It's a first-order recurrence with an inhomogeneous part. Next, we solve the recurrence. In this case, it's easy. You can do it by variation of the constants, but more generally, if you have higher order recurrences, you can also do this in sigma. And in this particular instance, we find a solution of the recurrence itself, so it's a particular solution, and we find a solution of the homogeneous version. So running over all these, over a certain field, we find all sequence solutions. However, by construction, our original sum, this ugly looking sum, is also a solution of the recurrence, so it must live in the solution space. So looking, for instance, at the value n equals 1, we evaluate that sum, and then we find that we have to choose for C the value 0. So in other words, this sum can be simplified in terms of the harmonic numbers and the harmonic numbers of second kind. This can be also done with sigma as follows. We define our truncated version of the sum. We compute a recurrence by using the comment generate recurrence. It's precisely the recurrence that you have seen earlier. We apply the comment limit recurrence to perform the limit. And finally, we solve the recurrence. Here is the homogeneous version. Here you see the particular solution. And finally, looking at the value n equals, at the evaluation at n equals 1, if we send a to infinity, this sum evaluates to 1/2. Using this fact, we find out that the homogeneous part can be neglected, and we find a linear combination which simplifies to that expression. Summarizing this sum here that you see simplifies to the harmonic numbers of first and second kind. And dealing with a special case k equals zero that has to be treated in addition, we end up finally to that expression. So now let's, so this was a warm-up example. Now let's turn to the difference ring machinery. So what you have seen basically is the following toolbox that is available in Sigma. We are given a summand, which depends on the summation variable k, and which might depend on a discrete parameter n. And the summand itself can be built by factorials, by Pochhammer symbols, binomials, by any factorial expressions, hypergeometric expressions, Q-hypergeometric expressions, mixed hypergeometric, multi-basic expressions, whatever you want in this case. And it can also depend on harmonic numbers and more generally in terms of indefinite nested sums and products. So there can be products of products be involved or sums of sums involved, defined over products, but they must be indefinite nested. And if the summand is built in a particular nice fashion, then we can use Doron-Thalberger's creative telescoping trick and we succeed to find a recurrence. Now there's also a strong recurrence solver involved, namely given a recurrence where the coefficients A0, A1 up to AD and the right-hand side H are given in terms of indefinite nested sums and products, then one can find all solutions which are again expressible within the class of indefinite nested sums and products. This is joint work with Sergei Abramov, Marco Petkovschek, and Manuel Brönstein, who unfortunately died. And this is a rather recent publication, and it took quite a long time until all the missing steps have been completed. So let me show you two examples. Here you find, see, for instance, a recurrence. It's of order 2. You see an, an plus 1, an plus 2. And the coefficients of the recurrence depend non-trivially on the harmonic numbers. And using the summation package sigma, you find two solutions. Here you can variate via C1 and C2. You find all solutions. And the solutions are built by the harmonic numbers and the product over the harmonic numbers. So this is one example. And here you see the product variation. So you see the coefficients of the recurrence are given in terms of factorials. And using the summation package sigma, you find all solutions. So you can run C1 and C2 over a certain field and you find all solutions over this field. And the solutions are built by a product over factorials, for instance, or a sum over factorials and 2 to I. And finally, if you find sufficiently many solutions, then you can try to combine the solutions such that you find an alternative solution as a definite sum. And this is the main point. You start with a definite sum and you can get rid of this dependence that n is on the upper bound and inside of the summand, and you can turn it to an indefinite summation expression. Let me demonstrate that on an example. So for instance, you see here, this hypergeometric expression in terms of the alternating sign, the binomial coefficient, and this denominator, and we sum over S, R, and J in this definite version. Now, how can we solve this? We start with the inner sum. Okay, this is a hypergeometric sum, and we look at the next summation quantifier, which is R. So we compute a recurrence. Here we could use also Doron-Thalberger's creative telescoping algorithm because it's a hypergeometric sum. Then we solve the recurrence in R and finally combine the solutions and find an expression, a linear combination of two hypergeometric terms. So this is technology like described in the famous book A equals B. Okay, by Doron-Thalberger, Herb Wilf, and Marco Petkovschek. In other words, this triple sum can be simplified to a double sum. Now let's repeat the game. I take that sum as input and look for a recurrence with respect to the next, with respect to the next summation quantifier J. I find the recurrence in J. I solve the recurrence in terms of indefinite nested sums and products where the upper bound is J and combine the solutions and I get that simplification. So if you compare the box here and here, it has a similar size, but there's a magic difference. Here you see the J, the upper bound, and you see it inside. It's poorly definite sum. It's complete. The J is everywhere. Whereas here you see the J only outside, but J does not arise anymore inside. It's an indefinite nested sum with respect to J. And that's, so in other words, we have simplified a double sum to a double sum. But now the main point is this input, the summand, fits exactly again to my input class. It's an indefinite nested product sum expression. And we can apply again the machinery. We can compute the recurrence with respect to N. We can find all indefinite nested sum and product solutions with upper bound N. We combine the solutions. And in the end, we find a closed form in terms of the harmonic numbers of second kind. And here the minus two as two, minus two means that we in addition have basically the harmonic numbers of second kind in addition involving the alternating sign. So this is a machinery in action. Now we can use, we can apply this automatically. We load in the summation package sigma, the harmonic sums package of Jakob Ablinger, which can deal nicely with special functions and supports us also with limit calculations, and the package evaluate multisums, which uses both packages and is doing all the things completely automatically. The user doesn't have to think. I basically encoded all my knowledge and all my heuristics, how I would try to tackle it, and they're encoded here. It's basically a human KI, which tries to do this smartly, these packages here, to do it automatically. So you insert the triple sum, and then you execute just evaluate multisums, apply it to the sum, and in about 1 minute, you get the closed form. Okay, now I would even jump a bit, want to dive a bit deeper into the machinery and want to show how the difference setting is applied internally. And let's do that.
Carsten, yeah? A quick question.
Sure.
Is it obvious a priori that the output will be of this type?
No, definitely not. If you give me an arbitrary sum, normally I will find a recurrence, but maybe I don't cannot solve it. So yeah. I don't find sufficiently many solutions, and then game is over.
So the point you're not so clever is that guessing it using this ansatz is so probably hopeless.
So this is again example from particle physics, and somehow they hope or they know that certain functions are behind, and then this machinery is just tailored for such things or for combinatorial problems where you know maybe the harmonic number for other objects are behind, then this machinery works nicely.
Thank you. It's beautiful. Mm-hmm.
Okay, now let's show a bit more details how this works. And let's do it with a very simple sum, namely we want to sum over the case harmonic numbers. How does this work?
Carsten, yeah? Could I ask a question before
sure.
you go on to this section? Suppose you're working on some problems where you don't have the harmonic numbers, harmonic sums, mm-hmm. but you have some other sums that you see all the time, perhaps
so
in number theory.
So I see more and more sums
that?
Where also central binomial coefficients pop up, and then sums defined over the central binomial coefficient. And other types of things, yeah.
So you could change it if I
yeah, 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 sure. It works within the class of indefinite nested sums and products.
Yes, okay, good, thank you.
So you see, internally, you see also such objects. If this would be the final thing and you wouldn't sum over J, that would be the final output. And this is an indefinite nested sum, it's not the harmonic numbers. It's still definite with respect to N, but not with respect to J.
Yes.
Okay. So I'm great that you ask questions and that you're curious how the machinery works, hopefully. So this works in a formal ring. So in this case, let's join the variable x to the rational numbers. So we have this rational function field. And then in addition, I join this variable. So we have this polynomial ring. And basically the main idea is that the harmonic numbers are modeled by this variable. Okay. So I have to give a meaning to the variable, and I do this by introducing an evaluation function. So I have to say how the variables x and s are evaluated to give it a meaning. So if you see a rational function, we all know, I guess, how we should evaluate them. You take the numerator and the denominator polynomial, and then you evaluate the polynomials as long as there is no pole in the denominator. And if there's a pole, well, we have a problem, but not a too big problem. In this case, I just say, if there's a pole, I evaluate it to zero. You could choose any other value. I prefer to choose zero, okay? So whenever you have a rational function, we know how to evaluate it at a certain point. Now we want to evaluate as the variable s. And as I said, the s should model the harmonic numbers. So it's nothing more straightforward to say, if I want to evaluate the variable s at the point n, it's just the nth harmonic numbers. But now it's natural how to enhance this evaluation function for this polynomial ring. Namely, whenever you take a polynomial, the coefficients are from the rational function field, then you evaluate the fi's by f prime. This is just the evaluation of rational functions. And whenever you see the variable s, you replace s by the nth harmonic numbers. So whenever you have a polynomial, you know it represents basically a polynomial expression in terms of the harmonic numbers. And with eval applied to this polynomial, we have an evaluation. Okay. And clearly, if you take an element from the ring, from this polynomial ring, you can evaluate it at the point n equals 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Basically, you go from this ring into the ring of sequences, and the evaluation function naturally gives you a sequence. And please note that this map that you can easily define is almost a ring homomorphism. It's not a ring homomorphism because we have poles. So for instance, if you apply tau x and tau of 1 over x, well, we can evaluate x. So we get 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is the poor evaluation. And if you want to evaluate 1 over x, well, at the point n equals 0, 1 over 0, this is a pole. So I define 0. But 1 over 1 is 1, 1 over 2 is 1 half, 1 over 3 is 1 third. So you get that sequence. And in this ring of sequences, we can define a multiplication naturally. It's component-wise multiplication. And you see, we almost get the 1 sequence, which would be the neutral element with respect to multiplication, except because of the pole. Here we have a 0. So we are very close to a ring homomorphism, tau of x times 1 over x, which should fulfill the ring homomorphism property. This should be the 1 sequence. So only the pole causes a problem. And now we follow a trick that you see also in the book A equals B. We say that two sequences are considered as equal if they agree from a certain point. So we can throw away finitely many poles. They are not important. If they cause problems, we just say we throw them away. This is chunk, but from a certain point on, the sequence will be the same. And in this, you can form equivalence classes, and you can easily see that saying two sequences, if they agree up to a certain point, this forms again a ring. You have again multiplication and addition component wise. And with this trick, we turn the whole thing to a ring homomorphism. Suddenly, these two sequences are the same. And it's even stronger. What we have here, we go from this polynomial ring into the ring of sequences. It's an injective ring homomorphism. So it's injective, it's a ring embedding. And that's a cool thing. Okay, so we have given the variables a meaning. And now we have to define the shift operator. And we do this by defining a ring automorphism. So it's clear if we have a rational function, we know how to shift a rational function. We replace x by x plus 1. And it's also naturally, if you look at the harmonic numbers, if we shift the harmonic numbers, this gives the harmonic numbers plus 1 over n plus 1. So it's just naturally to say, well, if we shift the variable s, it should be mapped to s plus 1 over x plus 1. And therefore, if whenever you have a polynomial, you shift the coefficients of the polynomial as you would shift a rational function. And whenever you see s, you replace it by s plus 1 over x plus 1. This forms a ring automorphism. And this tuple, this ring A and the automorphism sigma, this is also called a difference ring, which is one of the key words in my talk. And interestingly enough, if you look at the set of constants, all elements which are kept invariant with respect to the shift operator, this is called the set of constants or the constant field. And in our particular example that you see here, the set of constants are just the rational numbers. So whenever you apply the automorphism to a polynomial and it's constant, then it cannot depend on the variable x and it cannot depend on s. So the constants are precisely the rational numbers, which is a special case of an R pi sigma ring, and which is again a special case of Kahr's difference ring or difference field theory of pi sigma fields. So here, this is a key construction of Michael Kahr's work from the 80s.
But your notion is much more general, right?
It's more general because I allow also root of unities or something like that. So I skip this, but you can bring in roots of unities and can work with zero divisors. Yes.
And the motivation was a continuous theory of integration.
Yeah, so basically algebraic functions in the differential case is something like the alternating sign or root of unities in the ring setting.
Yeah.
And now, well, we have now defined a formal ring to model the objects. We gave it meaning to the variables by the evaluation and we defined a shift operator. And now the main point is that the evaluation function and the automorphism in the shift operator, they interact. Namely, first, shifting in the formal ring and then evaluating at the point n is the same as evaluating at the point n plus one. So they fit nicely together, the two meanings. And you can also carry this over on the ring embedding tau. You can shift first in the variable and then you interpret it as a sequence. This is the same as you shift the sequence. As you know, on the sequence level, we shift by moving all the things one to the left or to the right. So we first interpret it as sequence and then we shift. So in other words, this diagram commutes. We can shift formally or we can shift on the sequence level. And we can first shift and then go to the sequence, or we can first go to the sequence and then shift, and the whole thing commutes. So what you see here is an injective difference ring homomorphism or a difference ring monomorphism. And that's a cool thing. So in other words, this formal ring working with variables is the same as working in this ring of sequences, but this is an infinite object. It's hard to work, but it's nice to work with variables. And this map tau is a one-to-one correspondence between the two worlds. So this is the main point now. I want to find a summation problem for this sum. So given the harmonic numbers, I want to find a sequence G in this ring which has infinitely many objects, it's infinitely many described, such that this telescoping equation on the sequence level works. But now we have a one-to-one correspondence between this formal ring and this ring of sequences. So solving this problem is equivalent to look for a G in this formal ring such that this difference equation holds. And this is now the computer algebra level. On this computer algebra level, I find that expression G bar. And now I can use this one-to-one correspondence. I find an expression on the sequence level. And this solves me the telescoping problem. And so by the telescoping trick, finally, I find this evaluation. So very quickly, what I can do in sigma is you give me an expression in terms of indefinite nested sums and products. Then I apply the comment sigma reduce that you have seen earlier. And I find an alternative expression B such that A equals B, like following the paradigm in the famous book A equals B. But the main point is the expression B is again given in terms of indefinite nested sums and products. But these objects are algebraic independent among each other. So they don't satisfy polynomial relations. And application one is reducing the objects so that they have no relations anymore among each other. This allows to compactify expressions. Second application is I have a canonical simplification. So you can take an expression A1 and an expression A2, and you ask yourself, in terms of indefinite nested sums and products, and you ask yourself, do they evaluate to the same sequence? What you can do now is you apply sigma reduce simultaneously to B1 and B2. Then we can guarantee that A1 equals B1 and A2 equals B2. This is just I reduce. But I have the following strong property, namely B1 equals to B2 at each point from a certain point on, if and only if B1 is syntactically equals to B2. So if I simplify A1 and A2 to two expressions, and if they're syntactically equal, this is if and only if the input expression is the same. So this is called a canonical representation, that I have a unique representation. And immediately I have, can solve the zero recognition problem. A1, the input, simplifies to the zero expression if and only if the simplified expression equals the zero expression syntactically. So this is a very strong property. And I cannot give you details now how all these algorithms work, but the main feature is that all the summands here that you see, all the coefficients that you see here, they are all expressed in such a difference ring where no algebraic relations exist, where I have a canonical representation. And this makes this tool so efficient because I have an optimal representation. Okay. Maybe this was too complicated for you.
I'm curious. How long did it take to do this paper, because Bronstein died a long time ago?
Yeah, there were many things, problems open, and I worked with Marco Petkovic together, and finally we completed all the gaps here. It took long, so only last year we finally succeeded with all the things that we wanted to have.
It's very impressive, it's so general.
And this is related to Michael Singer's work, solving Liouvillian, finding Liouvillian solutions over recurrences defined over Liouvillian fields. This is a corresponding result. And it took much longer for us, or for the discrete version, I think it's much harder. It took us much longer, but we relied a lot on Michael Singer's ideas. So without his giant ideas, maybe we would have failed. But
so Michael Singer was continuous, so you do, but usually the discrete is even more difficult. So
yeah, it was a bit more difficult. So now let's go to challenging applications. And challenging can have two meanings. It can have the meaning these are difficult problems, or it can also mean that you, a nice colleague challenged you by problems. And somehow this part has these double meanings in several sense. So let's start with the challenging applications in number theory. And the first email I have to show, it was from Doron. This was, I think, 15 years ago when I was still younger. And when I got this email, I was quite nervous. So he wrote to Robin Pimentel and Herb Wilf, I'm willing to bet that Carsten Schneider's sigma package for handling sums with harmonic numbers can do it in a jiffy. I'm CCing this to Carsten. Carsten, do it. And CC the answer to me, Doron. So when I got this email, it took me a week in a hot summer. And finally, I managed it. And the problem was as follows. It's a problem from Robin Pimentel. And you see here basically an infinite sum, the sum over k and j from 1 to infinity. And again, the harmonic numbers are involved. And Robin suspected that it might be 1, but he was not sure. And this was embarrassing for him. If something is 1, you should write the constant 1, and you should not write this ugly sum. So he wanted to know what is the real evaluation. And here you see the solution, and it's basically like the warm-up example. We start with inner sum and compute a recurrence. We solve the recurrence. It's a recurrence of order 2. So I find two linearly independent solutions of the recurrence, which completely solves the recurrence, plus a particular solution. So the sum must live in the solution space. And looking at the value k equals 1 tells us C1 must be 0. And C2 must be theta of 2, where theta stands for the Riemann theta function. So in other words, this infinite sum evaluates to the harmonic numbers of second kind, and Riemann theta function evaluated at 2. And applying the second summation quantifier is simply telescoping. And we obtain this simplification in terms of theta 2, theta 3, and theta 5, which is close to 1. But actually, it's not
one. That's very nice.
Okay.
Very good.
So I want to show, and Doron said you can do it in a Jiffy. And in a Jiffy, you can indeed do it. So let's load in the three packages into Mathematica. Okay, now it's loaded in. I define this double infinite sum, and I execute evaluate multisums, and then all the tools are done automatically, and in around, yeah, let's say 10 seconds. And we finally find, let's see, it takes a bit more time. And we finally, where is the result? Okay, here is the result in terms of theta 2, theta 3, and theta 5.
Wow. Very good, very good.
So it's really done in a jiffy without thinking.
So how does it know the zetas? I noticed that they're like custom variable names, Z1, Z2, et cetera. How does it know those?
So there's also the package harmonic sums involved. And in the end, basically, I find something like truncated Euler sums or truncated versions. And we have theta relations calculated, which are encoded internally and support the user to find then in the end the final result. So they're quasi shuffle algebras related relations coming from integral identities. And I claim we have all the known relations for multiple theta values encoded up to a certain weight. We still don't know if there are more relations. We don't know if they're transcendental or not. We have no idea, but I think we have all the relations which are on the market. And I believe these are all relations that exist. But no proof. This is heuristic. It's an experimental mass in some sense. Okay, here's another example. This was a problem that Vadim Sutelin conjectured, and he showed it to me, and finally I managed to prove it. You see here the expression RT. It depends on the variable T and discrete parameters N and M. And if you specialize N and M to be integers, then this evaluates to a polynomial. And also R tilde, it's defined with this definite sum. If you specialize N and M to be integers, it's also a polynomial in T. And he conjectured, if you differentiate this expression with respect to T and sum over that expression, and you differentiate this twice with respect to T, and then you sum over T in this way, then the two identities agree. And interestingly enough, if you evaluate for n equals 1 and m for a certain value, then this can be evaluated as theta 4 times a rational function plus another rational function. And this was a thrilling thing for Vadim Sutelin. If such identities exist, which are related to theta 4, then there's something magic behind. And he conjectured that, and he wanted to know, is this identity true that I conjectured? And well, it took me 2 weeks, and finally, or 3 weeks, and finally I managed to prove it, and this was quite hard. So the proof tactic is as follows. We look at the two sums, and I compute for both of them a recurrence, and surprisingly enough, both sides satisfy the same recurrence, and it's a beautiful, simple recurrence. It's of order 2, and the coefficients are very nice. And let's just look at the right-hand side, which is the harder thing. You look at the right-hand side, and I have to split the sum into three parts. And I don't know if you know this, if you apply the differential operator to the gamma function, to a parameter, then you sneak in the harmonic numbers. Or if you apply the Pochhammer symbols in a certain way to a parameter and you differentiate with respect to that parameter, you get the harmonic numbers involved. So if you apply twice the harmonic numbers, twice the differential operator, you get quite some harmonic numbers involved. And for instance, for that sum, you get that expression. It's a double sum. And here you see a summand where you see the S1. This is the first page, second page, third page. It's a big summand. And using sigma, just using generate recurrence, you find a recurrence of order two, where the right-hand side is rather ugly, I must say, but it's indefinite nested. And you find another recurrence, shifts in J, but also shifts in M, again with the right-hand side. So basically using these two recurrences, you have a holonomic system approach. It's again in the setting like Doran has introduced in the 90s, but you also work with right-hand sides in terms of indefinite nested sums and products, which can be represented in my difference ring setting. And using sigma with this holonomic difference ring approach, where you can also deal with right-hand sides, you find within about 15 minutes a recurrence, it's of order two, with a rather ugly right-hand side. I don't show it to you. And you can do this also for that sum and for that sum, and they all three satisfy the same left-hand operator, but with very ugly right-hand sides. And then you use the comment sigma reduce, this canonical representation, and we reduce all the objects. And in the end, we get the big zero. So summarizing, we have established that both sides satisfy the same recurrence, and we check two initial values, which is another round of symbolic summation. And we have established the identity by Vadim Tsutlin. Name is that one. Okay, there are also combinatorial problems.
Carsten, for this one, you need quite a bit of human ingenuity, right? You cannot just plug it in right away. You have to do a lot of pre-processing.
Yeah, the hardest nut was to write this in a certain way and to write the summons in terms of harmonic numbers, because the harmonic numbers only are possible to represent the differential operation. This object symbolically was non-trivial in terms of harmonic numbers. And it took me quite a while until I find out how to do this properly.
So you need the Carsten ingenuity. You cannot just have the computer do this one.
There was also, and I claim, for me, this was one of the hardest nuts that I have done. And to see this with a poor polynomial approach without using difference ring theory, I'm curious, but this must be gigantic recurrences. Hmm. And even you have to deal with the boundaries. It's highly non-trivial.
Thank you.
Okay, challenging applications in combinatorics. There was another email by Doron just last year or 2 years ago, namely the following. I, in Chalosh, just posted a paper with a challenge to you. Can you and sigma extend theorem 5 of that paper to the general case with k absent-minded passengers? If you and sigma can do the fourth moment and derive the asymptotic in N with a fixed but arbitrary K, I will donate $100 to the OAAIs in your honor. Best wishes, Doron. So this took me also several weeks or even months, but I can say this email provoked various heavy calculations by means of computer algebra that solved fully the above challenge. And it's also based on beautiful results of Doron. So I relied on his great work to do this. And in the following, I cannot show you all the details. I just want to pick out two symbolic aspects, namely where symbolic summation has been used. So what was the problem? We are given passengers, N passengers, who want to sit in a plane with N seats. And K passengers are upset. They completely lost their tickets. And well, they were desperately, and they were just sitting down the first random place that they see. The rest, K passengers, N minus K passengers, they all had their tickets. And of course, if they had the right place, they sit down as they're supposed to sit down. But if the place was already occupied by an absent-minded passenger, then they also randomly sat down at a certain place. And hence and last, they showed that the expected value that a passenger was sitting on the wrong place is this expression, and the variance is that. And Doron greatly extended their work and computed, derived the formula for many moments. And I supported a little bit to find expressions in terms of harmonic numbers. But I just want to show you these two sums. They can be treated again straightforwardly. Insert the expression by the expected value, execute the command evaluate multisums, and voila, you get within seconds and this expression in terms of the harmonic numbers. And similar, you can insert the variance, a typical combinatorial problem. You insert, you execute the command evaluate multisum again, and within seconds, you get that expression. Now, let me quickly say that this can be also, this what I worked now the last 20 years can be also strongly used in particle physics. And let me zoom very quickly that elements, particles can be, the behaviors of particles can be described by diagrams, Feynman diagrams, and they can be translated to Feynman integrals, very complicated mathematical objects. I don't have details, but let me say, this is maybe one of the simplest Feynman diagrams that you can imagine that I deal, but they are more complicated. You see, they might be a six-fold integrals. There might be discrete parameters that we have to sum. In the end, you have such a complicated expression. And let me say, this is expression is hyper-exponential in the integration variables and hyper-geometric with respect to the summation variables. So you could use the multivariate and this Zeilberger algorithm, but the underlying linear system is very, very complicated. So the idea is, well, the idea is we don't use definite integration, but we use symbolic summation by transforming the object to multisums. And here we can use all the strong tools that we have seen earlier. So for instance, that integral that you see can be simplified in a sense to this six-fold sum, where the summand is again a hypergeometric expression times a linear combination of harmonic sums. Exactly a summation problem as you have seen earlier, just bigger. And now we zoom from inside to outside, computer occurrences, solve them, combine the solutions. You get very, very ugly indefinite nested sums and products. But in the end, everything collapses to this nice expression. And you see here the harmonic numbers of second kind. And the most complicated object is this indefinite nested sum, which is if you send to infinity, you get multiple theta values, but you have all the properties. If you send n to infinity, you get multiple theta values. You can do asymptotic expansions, you know, the logarithmic behavior. You can do asymptotic expansions, all the things that what the physics guys need. And soon we are ready to use all these results of thousands of integrals that we have evaluated to apply them to the Large Hadron Collider at CERN. Yeah, and with that final application, I would like to stop my talk, hopefully still in reasonable time.
Well, does anyone have any questions for Carsten? We have time for a few quick official questions.
A quick question. It's really, really impressive, all these applications to so many different things. Mm-hmm. Is the famous Higgs boson, was it used, this technique?
Yes. So my colleagues told me that the predicted Higgs boson has still to be compared to the properties of the new particle. And our calculations will help to understand if really the prediction and the found results in the Large Hadron Collider, if they agree. So this can be helped. Another interesting aspect is that four fundamental forces, the question is if they unite to a final point for high energies. And it looks like that they unite, but if you're very close for high energies, actually the four forces do not meet. And my colleagues, they are very eager to see if our new precision calculations, so if then the curves come closer or if they go further away. This could be an indication if maybe the four fundamental forces really unite, at least an indication.
So you may get a Nobel Prize in physics.
I don't think so, but I'm proud to contribute a little bit and I'm I'm very happy to make my colleagues happy with these calculations.
Karsten, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
When you were working on Zudilin's conjecture about the rational expressions, you said there was a lot of human pre-processing that went into it before you could feed it into Sigma, right?
Yeah.
How did you check that your human pre-processing was correct?
Well, for what I did for Vadim Tudelin, we just derive, we develop it in the paper, and it's clear that one can follow these calculations.
But it wasn't so complicated that you had to use a computer to do the derivation.
No, this was not so complicated. In particle physics communities, there are tools and they are very heavy and strong packages developed within the last 30, 40 years, using also other computer algebra systems, which can work with terabytes of expressions, where they transform these expressions. And then we do calculations. And in the end, we have final results. And the good thing is that many of these results, parts of these results, pop up in earlier calculations. So you can compare by independent calculations that we do if at least the partial results agree. This is a good indication that everything is correct. And then you also can do the numerics and the expected value, and you can see again if it fits or not. But I agree, to turn this all to rigorous proofs, this would be a challenge. I don't know if it's possible, but the particle physics community is happy what we are producing, for instance.
Okay, are there any other questions for Karsten? No? Okay, well, let's thank the speaker one more time for staying up so late to give us his wonderful talk. Okay, so that concludes this week for the seminar. We'll be back here at the same time next week with a different speaker. So thanks again, Karsten, for being here so late.
Thanks that I had the chance to present my talk. I'm very proud to be in this community and to show my work.
Thank you.
Okay, goodbye, everyone.
Good. Yeah, thank you. Ciao.